It gives me great pleasure indeed to actually talk to a group of fellow enthusiasts. I know that all of you are dermatologists. Nobody who comes to a meeting like this is inexperienced. All of you are highly experienced. All of you are senior enough. All of you see a lot of psoriasis throughout your life. So let me talk about why I need to talk to you and what is it that has a value in our meeting today. I have been treating psoriasis for nearly 30 years, like many of you have. And we know that this is one of those things where we do not have easy answers. Psoriasis is almost lifelong chronic illness with a huge impact cumulatively on the quality of life in many ways. I don't want to go into each and every one of them right now. All of you are aware that the impact of psoriasis, especially the severe form, is so bad that the cost of care can be worse than a bad heart attack, a serious road traffic accident, and even a malignancy put together. Therefore, we as dermatologists have a unique opportunity of treating our patients and bringing a smile to them and making a huge difference in the quality of life. So, without much ado, let me start with the first slide. See, we were there, but of course we are no longer there. The history of psoriasis is very funny. If you want to put it in a nutshell, the preclinical era, the early clinical era, the histopathology and histogenesis era, and the modern biologic era. Psoriasis was confused with leprosy for many years. And it was accurate clinical observation which told that leprosy is a different condition and psoriasis is a different condition. But as recently as 150 years ago in Europe, people with psoriasis were made to wear a bell around their neck and were kept away from others because there was a lot of confusion between leprosy and psoriasis. All those things passed and we realized that psoriasis is a different condition. It's not infectious like leprosy. It's not caused by a bacteria. And we started the era of clinical dermatology where we started describing skin lesions according to the appearance. So the papulosquamous disorder of psoriasis came to be known. And it was observed that nearly 85% of patients have a very standard appearance, that is the stable plaque psoriasis. And one third of patients do seem to have joint pains and swelling, arthritis, and there are some forms of psoriasis which are totally different also. So coming to the next stage, we realize that in psoriasis, when you take a skin biopsy, as if the snake skin sheds visibly in psoriatic plaques, the skin turnover is so fast that the shedding of the skin becomes visible. In other words, you have red scaly patches and plaques, classical distribution. And the main thing is, it seems as if the skin cell, the keratinocyte, is at fault. This led to a phase where we seem to be excited and we seem to know the exact cause of psoriasis. And this was the phase when the clinical observations, like the fact that psoriasis occurs in twins very frequently, that psoriasis has a very strong family history and that psoriasis does not seem to affect people in certain places. For example, the Faroe Islands is full of psoriasis, whereas the Red Indian of South America almost never seem to get psoriasis. So clearly there's a genetic predisposition. And at the same time, it was recognized that probably the skin cell, the keratinocyte, is at fault. This was again a phase of treatment of psoriasis, which was empirical in nature. Psoriasis has been treated from biblical times. We know that cold tar application, exposure to the Dead Sea, is pretty effective in psoriasis. Even though we didn't know why exactly this works, but it has been in vogue for a long time. And then this led to the modern era of the phototherapy, wherein we started using the phototherapeutic chambers, and then we thought that we can reduce the rate of turnover of the skin cells.
Of course, methotrexate made a huge difference. And when we jump to the era of methotrexate, that is the late 20th century, methotrexate was a cell poison which used to retard the rate at which the cell grows and divides and comes to the surface. This is what we thought initially. And the interesting thing about that is it was not till transplantation of organs started, till the cyclosporine era, that we really started suspecting that psoriasis is not a problem of the skin, but rather of the immune system of the body. When cyclosporine reached the scene, we realized that cyclosporine, which does not seem to affect the rate of turnover of cells in the skin, makes a huge difference in patients with psoriasis. A kidney transplant patient on cyclosporine, if he has psoriasis, almost seems to get cured from psoriasis. Therefore, it became pretty apparent that it is the alteration in the immune cells which is important in psoriasis. Here, multiple things happen, almost at a very rapid rate. The first was the Human Genome Project. The Human Genome Project was a project which was developed mainly by physics people, wherein X-ray crystallography was used to identify the human genes, and mapping of human genes happened. In fact, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore was one of the major centers where it was done. My brother-in-law was part of this project, in fact. And by the late 20th century, almost all the genes involved in psoriasis were more or less identified. And at the same time, 1974 was a watershed year when the monoclonal antibody was discovered and got a Nobel Prize. When they discovered it, they didn't think it would be used for medicinal purposes. They thought maybe it's going to be of value in diagnostics. But time told us that monoclonal antibodies are more useful as targeted treatments, which can target specific molecules in the immune system and might be used in chronic inflammatory conditions and also in certain malignancies. Therefore, we are no longer in this era. Let me straight away come to my first case. My first case was a 45-year-old male with psoriasis of 15 years duration. He had come to me nearly 15 years ago in Dubai, and he was at that time recently married, and he didn't have children, and his psoriasis had been there for quite a long time, and it had started in the genital area with succinate patches, and the diagnosis of Reuters was considered. There was some joint swelling and pain which was not very prominent initially, and I had treated him with almost everything. I had sent him to CMC Vellore, my alma mater, and HLA P27 was done there. He was positive for that, and I had given him methotrexate, I had given him phototherapy, I had given him acid treating. Nothing seemed to work very well. Everything improved it temporarily. And then I had even sent him to Jordan for a spell of spa treatment and phototherapy. Finally, in 2016, when secukinumab arrived in Dubai, I decided to start him on secukinumab. His PASI at that time was 25.5, the body surface area was more than 20, the DLQI was 15, and the test was 3 out of 5. He had a swollen joint count of 2. A tender joint count of 4 and a PGA of 4. These are terms which we need to become familiar with. I am going to come to the nitty-gritty of what exactly we need to know before we start a patient on a biologic in a short while. But just to get through this story of this patient, his pre-secukinumab evaluation was normal, including the TB gold quantiferon. This was how he looked before and after just the third week after starting secukinumab. You see the significant improvement, almost a PASI 75% improvement from a very obvious psoriasis to near clear, almost within 3 weeks. You see the speed with which the medicine works. Now, secukinumab is given as an injection, being a biologic. The dose is 300 milligrams in an adult, And the initial, the loading phase, that is, we start on day one, which is called day zero. And then every week for 1, 2, 3, 4, basically 5 injections. After this, it's every month 300 milligrams. How long? Technically, forever. And practically, it's not forever always, but technically, we don't advise a patient to stop the medication. Now, it's very easy to give. It's a fully human monoclonal antibody. It's a UMAP. So for those who need to understand the terminology, secukinumab being a UMAP is fully human, and therefore the rate at which antibodies are produced is much less. The chance that the medicine will stop working is much less than, for example, if you are using a hybrid or a chimera or a ZUMAP or a ZMAP. The second thing is, being a fully human monoclonal antibody, injection site reactions are very, very, very rare. And the chance that you will get autoantibody formation against this protein is so low that the things like, for example, lupus erythematosus or other autoimmune conditions coming as a reaction to this injection is very low. Now let's go on to the next slide. See the kind of improvement the patient achieved. This is a photograph of the patient after about, let us say, 3 months. So within 12 weeks, the patient almost cleared totally. Now this is a graphic of studies comparing secukinumab with ustekinumab, and it shows the PASI 75 response within 4 weeks. See the significant difference between ustekinumab and secukinumab. Nearly 50% of patients who take this medication have a very significant, clearly visible improvement in, let us say, even by week 4. This is how the patient looks now. It made a huge difference to the quality of life to the patient. Patient was really stunned. He had used almost all other medications till then, but he never thought that he would have such a clear skin. He has been on the medication now for almost 4 years. He, touch wood, is almost absolutely clear, and he has had almost no side effects. There is no injection site reaction, and except occasional minor fever, cold that he gets, no significant side effect has occurred. He has adopted a son. They didn't have children of their own, and his life has transformed. Now, why interleukin 17A? To come back to the history, see, if you do a bone marrow transplant, you take bone marrow from a patient with psoriasis and give it to a person without psoriasis, he will get psoriasis. If you take bone marrow from a patient without psoriasis and transplant to a person with psoriasis, you can cure psoriasis. But seriously, it's not ethical to do bone marrow transplant for psoriasis. Bone marrow transplant is a serious issue, very expensive, a lot of complications, side effects. Ideally to be done for leukemia, thalassemia major, not for a condition like psoriasis. Therefore, it's obvious that we do know that the bone marrow is the most important factor in psoriasis pathogenesis. At the same time, we realize that maybe if we target the T cells, we can cure psoriasis. The initial targets of the biologics were the T cells. So for example, molecules like alifacept, like ifalizumab, which were produced initially in the early 2000s, were targeting the T cell as a whole. The interesting thing about these molecules were they produced improvement in a small percentage of patients with psoriasis with horrendous side effects. Therefore, they had to be withdrawn from the market, and it became clear that targeting the T cell directly is not a great idea, and therefore targets which were down the pathway, like for example tumor necrosis factor alpha blockage with a fusion protein like etanercept, which is actually half protein and half antibody and half protein, were used. But it was in 2016 that secukinumab was licensed, being an interleukin-17A blocker, it blocks interleukin-17A in almost all the targets, the skin, the joints, both peripheral and axial, the nail, the scalp, hard to treat areas like palms and soles, and it works both in the adaptive and the innate immune system. See, interleukin-17 is produced by not only Th17 cells, which are primed by interleukin-23, but also produced by the innate cells, for example, mast cells, neutrophils, innate cells, and lymphoid cells. The interesting thing about blocking interleukin-17A is that not only do you block the innate pathway, but you block the adaptive pathway also. So you get excellent results in stable plaque psoriasis, in arthritis, whether it's peripheral or axial, and hard to treat areas like palms, soles, nails, and scalp. Secukinumab has dedicated trials for almost all these aspects. It is licensed for moderate to severe plaque psoriasis in adults. It's licensed for axial and peripheral arthritis. It's licensed for ankylosing spondylitis. And it's, in fact, one of those molecules which is useful for all the domains or manifestations of psoriasis, be it in the skin, the joints, the nail, the scalp, the genital area, whether it's axial or peripheral. Now, let's talk about the guidelines. Guidelines keep changing. Guidelines are meant to be made for a particular time, and our knowledge of psoriasis has been changing so rapidly that the guidelines are evolving probably the fastest. These are the German S3 guidelines, and it is very simple. You classify psoriasis into two types, moderate to severe or mild. How do you classify? Based on body surface area or the PASI. If the body surface area of involvement is more than 10, or if the psoriasis area severity index is more than 10, we call it as moderate to severe. So let's forget the mild. The moment we have this, the patient is eligible to go down this track, which means he is eligible, or he or she is eligible, for phototherapy, for serious medications like acitretin, cyclosporin, fumaric acid esters, which are not available in this part of the world, methotrexate, or even the biologics which can be used as a first-line medication as per these guidelines. So what do you mean by that? What it means is, we can start a patient on a biologic, for example, adalimumab or secukinumab. Whether a patient has been naive for this group of medications, that is, has never used, or has already used and there has been a problem. What do you mean by a problem? Systemic medications basically have only three issues. One is effect. Was it effective enough? Question number one. Question number two, is there a contraindication? Question number three, is there a side effect? So for example, classically, if you are one of those people who use methotrexate a lot, methotrexate in an adult, given at, let us say, 20 milligrams per week, given for 8 to 12 weeks, if it does not produce a PASI improvement of at least 75%, it is definitely not successful. So that's a treatment failure. You are not going to give methotrexate to a patient who is obese, who is diabetic, who's got a non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, who is on aspirin because of cardiac issues, who is taking sulfa drugs, which are all interacting with methotrexate. So we don't buy problems by unnecessarily giving methotrexate to a patient where there may be a contraindication for using it. It's very common for patients on phototherapy, with psoriasis, to use Chinese herbal medicine or Ayurveda or homeopathy. Many native medications are hepatotoxic. It's definitely not a great idea to combine a native medication with methotrexate. You are not going to give acitretin in a young lady who is likely to become pregnant. So it's very, very simple, common sense. Is the medicine effective? Yes, no. No, biologic. Is the medicine contraindicated? Yes, no. No, biologic. Is there a side effect after having started a medication? Is there a side effect? Is there an abnormal liver function test or the platelets are going down? If any of these are there, straight away we come to the biologics. And not only that, even if all these things are not there, if there is a clear-cut indication, moderate to severe psoriasis, in this current era, there is really no justification in going down these medications. We can straight away go to the biologic. Therefore, the guidelines are pretty clear, and we can use secukinumab as a first-line biologic, whether a patient has been drug name, systemic drug name, systemic drug used, or in a patient who has already had a biologic or biologic name. So now let's come to the next guideline. This is the British Association of Dermatology guideline. The British Association of Dermatology guideline is almost similar. The algorithm is offer a biologic therapy to people who fulfill eligibility criteria. In other words, three questions only. Question number one, is this patient with psoriasis having a moderate to severe psoriasis eligible for a systemic treatment? If the answer is yes, definitely biologic can be considered. Tailor choice of the agent to the need of the person. What does it mean? Suppose the patient has an arthritis. As we all know, nearly 30% of patients do have arthritis. If the patient has an arthritis, straight away the guideline says we need to consider either adalimumab or secukinumab. Of course, depending on the response, we either continue therapy or we consider escalation of dose or we consider a change. We will come to those things later. Coming to my second case. This is a patient who was 48 years old and who had a high BMI. His BMI was 38 and he also had triglycerides which were very high. He had been treated with methotrexate about 3 years ago for about 6 months. Phototherapy also had been used 3 years ago. I didn't start him. He was treated with secukinumab in India by a doctor who gave him Scafo, which is the trade name for secukinumab in India. The interesting thing is the dose given. See, 600 milligrams of secukinumab was given every week for 5 weeks, followed by monthly 600 milligrams thereafter. This is not the licensed dose. This is not as per the label. This is not what we would definitely recommend. This is not something I'm trying to teach you, and I wouldn't recommend that you should start a dose like this. Only purpose of showing this particular patient is to show you the kind of improvement that he has and to tell you that excellent response, no major side effects, and till date the patient doesn't seem to have any issues. The safety profile of this medication is pretty good. So coming to how we start a patient on a biologic, it is simple. Question number one, severity of psoriasis. Question number two, response to previous treatments. Question number three, is there a contraindication? It's a three-step process in many senses. So the first thing is we need to know whether this patient has a severe enough psoriasis. How do you say severe psoriasis? First is body surface area. What do you mean by body surface area? The patient's palm is considered as 1%, and then using the patient's palm, the handprint of the psoriasis is calculated. For example, if you use this figure, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, this would be a body surface area of 7. So this is a very simple method using the patient's own palm. The thing is, we need to be cautious when you use this also. There are apps available. If you go use your smartphone and if you download an app, there's an app called Grappa app. If you download the Grappa app, it guides you through not only this body surface area, it makes sure that we don't make beginner's errors. What do you mean by beginner's errors? See, the body surface area of the head is maximum 10. We don't write to an insurance company saying that this head alone, head and neck alone is involved with psoriasis, and then the patient has a body surface area of 20. That's crazy. Okay, now coming to other methods. What is the advantage of body surface area? The advantage is that it is simple and it's something that is very practical, and it is accepted by many insurance companies. But the body surface area doesn't reflect the severity easily. We need to know the area, the severity, and we need an index. So the most commonly used index is the psoriasis area and severity index, called the PASI. It assesses the qualities including the severity in three means: the erythema, the scaling, and the induration. And it computes the severity depending on all these factors. And the utility is that if you have a good PASI scoring, you can compare what the PASI was at the beginning before treatment, for example 12 and 10, and then you can compute and say how much of an improvement in PASI we have achieved, whether we have achieved a PASI 75 or a 90% improvement. And it's very easy to for us to maintain these charts, and it's very easy for us to write to the insurance company and tell them that, look, this is the current situation. So erythema, induration, and scaling are graded in each area: the head and neck, the upper extremities, the trunk, and the lower extremities. You can have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, depending on the severity. And then you sum it up, and then each area has an area score and then a multiplier, which gives us the PASI. If you are a beginner, I would definitely tell you that the best way to do it is to use the app itself. If you use the Grappa app, you can have an idea of what you mean by 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. The issue is that in our skin, it's not exactly like this. So depending on the color of the skin, the Fitzpatrick type, we need to be aware that erythema can be defined slightly differently. But still, it's always wiser to use the app. Scaling, similar, use an app, use a reference scale, and then compute. Induration, similarly, please use the app and compute. Once you have, you need to know what percentage of body area is affected. This is just an example of a person who has involvement, surprisingly, in the flexor area of the forearms. Estimate of percentage of affected area is 20. Percentage is between 10 to 20. The answer is 2. And using the app, this is the Grappa app. I definitely recommend people to download this app. It is easy to calculate the PASI and the other tools that are required for managing patients with a biologic are easy to locate them. So you have a toolkit which is ready-made, and it's an app, and it's easy to use this to calculate. So once you have this calculation with you, you have a clear-cut idea of the severity. What do you mean by severity? It can be assessed even with a global score. What do you mean by a global score? Is the patient's skin clear, almost clear, mild, moderate, severe, or very severe? This can be computed for the redness, for the thickening, or the scaling. And if you calculate for all three together and divide by 3, you get a figure of 0 to 5. This is called a physician's global score, which is easy to do. Therefore, it is very easy for us, either using the patient's palm, which is used for body surface area, or use a PASI score using the app, or using the global assessment, again, which can be used with the toolbox and photography. The important thing is to remember the rule of 10. What do you mean by rule of 10? A patient has a body surface area more than 10, a patient who has a PASI of more than 10, or a global score which is 3 or 4, and a DLQI. What do you mean by DLQI? Dermatology Life Quality Index. Dermatology Life Quality Index is a questionnaire which is easy to do. It's easy to teach our nurses, and it's very, very easy to give the nurses these sheets and make the patient fill them up before they enter the clinic also. And this questionnaire, again, each question not only tackles the physical aspect but the subjective aspect of psoriasis and its impact on the quality of life of an adult, and again very much carries a weight of 3, not 2, little 1, not at all 0. 10 into 3, 30 is the maximum. If you get a score of 10 and above, it justifies systemic treatment, especially a biologic. Therefore, it's very simple. 3-step process. You have diagnosed psoriasis, you calculate the severity of the psoriasis, you pass the rule of 10 and say this is a moderate to severe psoriasis. Step 1, you are clear. The patient is eligible for a biologic. Step 2, we always assess a patient thoroughly. We are all good physicians. So the most common issue in psoriasis is arthritis. We need to pick up arthritis as early as possible. If you delay diagnosing arthritis by more than 6 months, it can lead to permanent damage. Therefore, one of the most sensitive tools for diagnosing or picking up arthritis, there are many tools, but still the most sensitive and the simplest is a PEST score. PEST score, again, is a simple questionnaire. Have you ever had a swollen joint or joint? Yes, no. Has a doctor ever told you you have an arthritis? Yes, no. You have fingernails or toenails with pits in them? Yes, no. Have you had pain in your heel? Have you had a finger or toe which was completely swollen or painful? Yes, no. You are assessing whether the patient has a dactylitis, an enthesitis, and a possible arthritis. If 3 out of these 5 questions are positive, chance that we are dealing with a psoriasis with an arthritis is very high. Therefore, if you have a PEST score, please use it every visit the patient comes. And make sure that you collaborate with a rheumatologist. It's not wise for a dermatologist to go around treating a patient with primarily an arthritic psoriasis. Always have a rheumatologist colleague and collaborate with them to get the best possible outcomes for our patient. In case anybody is interested, you do have specific severity gradings, for example, for the nail, for the palms and soles, for the scalp. As a beginner, it's not required. Even insurance companies are not very keen on an APSI score. If you try to do a nail area severity index, it takes a long time. It's a very time-consuming process. If anybody wants to assess the nail, there are 2 methods which are recommended. One is a global assessment, mild, moderate, severe kind of thing, or a targeted NAPSI. What do you mean by targeted NAPSI? Please do not do a NAPSI on the toenails. Rule number 1. Rule number 2, use it only for fingernails. Rule number 3, look at all the 10 fingernails, decide which is the worst fingernail and do a NAPSI only for that finger. So the worst affected finger is chosen, and you need to look at the matrix signs and the nail bed signs. You need to look at whether the patient has leukonychia, red spots in the luna, the nail crumbling. You need to look for onycholysis, winter hemorrhage, oil drop signs. It's very easy. Again, you will find this in the GRAPPA toolbox. And in case somebody is interested, you can definitely do a NAPSI score in case you want to start a patient. The CASPAR score, all of us know the CASPAR score. I'm not here to teach you dermatology. You're all expert dermatologists already. The CASPAR score is a highly specific criteria. It's not that sensitive, but it's one of the things which is used to make a diagnosis of a psoriatic arthritis. See, psoriatic arthritis is a spondylo-negative arthritis. There is no specific test which tells this is psoriatic arthritis. It's as simple as that. It's the criteria. What is special about psoriatic arthritis? There's an enthesopathy or enthesitis. There's a dactylitis, which is not usually found in most of the other spondyloarthropathies. And you have an erosive arthropathy, the earliest sign of which can be picked up by doing an ultrasound. In trained hands, the ultrasound shows there is inflammation of the enthesis, which is the soft tissue surrounding the joint, along with the joint erosion. So this, in a nutshell, is the difference between psoriatic arthritis and the other arthritis. Of course, the Merlin rights criteria and the classifications, all those things are there. I don't want to go into that in detail. What we need to know as a beginner who wants to start a patient off on psoriasis, only four things. Does the patient have moderate to severe psoriasis? Question number one. How do you do that? See, does the patient have a PASI which is above 10, a DLQI above 10? Yes, no. Yes means yes. We have a patient who can be put on a biologic. No means probably not eligible for a biologic. Additional comments. What do you mean by additional comments? If the patient has already been treated with a conventional system, only three questions. Was it effective? Is there a contraindication for the conventional systemic? And is there a side effect with the conventional systemic? If you have any of these, and if this is yes, no insurance company on earth can say no if, as per their policy, the biologic is covered. Of course, if the insurance says that as per our policy, biologic is not covered, that's a different story. But step one, is the patient having a moderate to severe psoriasis and eligible for a biologic? If you get an answer yes here, it's straight away clear. Now what is step two? Step two is there a contraindication for a biologic? What do you mean by contraindication for a biologic? Does the patient have an infection which is significant at that time? Yes, no. Is there any demyelinating disease like an optic neuritis or a multiple sclerosis? Any neurological issue which is major? This is important in the choice or type of biologics. Most of the older conventional TNF alpha blockers aren't licensed in a patient with a demyelinating disease. Does the patient have a class 3, class 4 heart failure? Like that patient is gasping and climbing up the steps and coming, you are not going to give a TNF alpha blocker. You are going to collaborate with a cardiologist and you are going to make sure that this is not a patient for a TNF alpha blocker at all. Has the patient got a malignancy? Active malignancy on treatment or a history of malignancy? Yes, no. Now, have you done the basic evaluation? Urine analysis, pregnancy test? Are you dealing with a lady who can be pregnant or likely to be pregnant or breastfeeding? Of course, the chance that we are going to start a patient like that on a biologic is not great, but in case you do start, you need to start the appropriate antibiotics. Biologics. Most biologics are okay in the first two trimesters of pregnancy. The last trimester, we stop it mainly to protect the baby, because the immunosuppression might be persisting in the baby, which might require immunizations, which may be live vaccines, to be postponed during breastfeeding. Currently, of course, you have paginated Certolizumab Pegol, which is licensed and which doesn't cross the placental barrier, which can be used even in the third trimester of pregnancy. But as far as secukinumab is concerned, if the patient is already on it, can be continued up to the second trimester, but the company doesn't give a license to use it during pregnancy or breastfeeding. Okay, now next, a chest x-ray, TB gold quantiferon, a MAN2, has it been done? Does the patient have either tuberculosis or related tuberculosis? The answer is interesting. If a patient has a latent tuberculosis, we wouldn't give him a conventional, the older type TNF-alpha blockers definitely. I have more than 35 patients on secukinumab, I have got more than 12 patients on ixekizumab, I have got 2 patients on Tremfya, I have got 4 or 5 patients on Humira, I have got more than about 50-60 patients on biologics currently, right now in my clinic, taking biologics. Looked in 17 alpha blockers and tuberculosis, there's no issue. I have at least 6 patients who are TB gold quantiferon positive, who do not have clinically overt tuberculosis, who never got it reactivated by using a interleukin 17 blocker. I am aware that the current ones, for example, risankizumab, Skyrizi, they have some dedicated studies for TB gold quantiferon positive patients. And they are running some trials on patients to see whether it comes out. But with secukinumab, I can tell you my personal experience, a latent tuberculosis is not an issue. What happens if there is a hepatitis B or a hepatitis C or a HIV? The textbook advises treat the hepatitis B, hepatitis C, treat the HIV, use a HAART and continue the biologic. It's not a contraindication, but it's just a fact that you need to be aware and you need to make sure that you treat that also. What about autoantibodies? If the patient already has autoantibodies, we wouldn't like to give a TNF alpha blocker, or we wouldn't like to give an infliximab to a patient like this IV and all that. We would choose something which is more fully human monoclonal antibody, and which this is not an issue. So this is the basic workup that is required before. The only question that is left is only two more questions. Does the patient require a vaccination? If the patient has completed the age appropriate vaccinations recommended by the government at every country, there is no further question at this point. We are dealing with adult patients with moderate to severe psoriasis. We are not talking about the pediatric age group. Live vaccines are hardly ever used in this age group. The Britishers are extremely worried about chickenpox. So whether the patient has had a history of chickenpox or having antibodies against varicella, they are very much worried. And BAD recommends that pneumococcal vaccine and influenza vaccine, whether it has been given, should be recorded in the sheet before the biologic is started. And the last thing is confirm whether the patient has been screened as per the national cancer screening programs of each nation. Mammograms, pap smears, colorectal evaluations, if as per protocol, if there is any requirement that has to be completed before you do a start a patient on a biologic. By and large, these are not issues. In fact, starting a patient on a biologic, especially secukinumab, is easy. Three-step process. Patient has moderate to severe psoriasis. Patient has no contraindication. Patient has failed previous treatment. Pre-secukinumab evaluation is by and large normal. There's no tuberculosis. There's no active infection. You can start. Now, coming to the more detailed checklist, this is almost the same thing, but see, all these things, for example, demyelinating disease, tuberculosis, hepatitis B, C, the history of malignancy, non-melanoma, melanoma, cancers, phototherapy, whether the patient has already been on, possibility of pregnancy, possibility of breastfeeding, history of BCG vaccination, pneumococcal vaccines, clinical examination in detail. So this is a very interesting checklist. It's very easy to download this checklist. It not only gives you the pre-biologic evaluation protocol, it also has the post-biologic protocol where you monitor the patient after 3 months and then 6 months and then after that only once in 6 months. Very frequent blood tests are not required. Patients on secukinumab hardly ever get side effects to a major extent. I have, like I said, a lot of patients. Injection site reaction, almost never. Candidiasis, they talk a lot about candidiasis. All of you are aware that there's a genetic interleukin 17A lacking condition in which patients manifest with mucocutaneous candidiasis. But though technically interleukin 17A blockers can possibly produce candidiasis, in my experience, I haven't seen a significant clinical candidiasis in any of my patients. That's a fact. Of course, we need to be aware. This is not something to tell you that candidiasis is not going to occur. No. Yes, you should keep it in mind. Inflammatory bowel disease. If a patient has a very significant clear inflammatory bowel disease like an ulcerative colitis or Crohn's, giving an interleukin 17A blocker may not be a great idea. So that is the only thing that we need to keep in mind. Otherwise, we are dealing with a molecule which works in almost all the domains of psoriasis. I don't want to go into that too much. So now, simple. We have a patient with moderate to severe psoriasis. We have done the pre-biologic evaluation. We have started a patient on the biologic. Now, how do you say whether you are successful or not? Like I told you, bare minimum, we need at least a PASI. And a DLQR, two. So the PASI and DLQR are very important. If you have a PASI And if after the treatment, if the PASI improvement is at least 75, you are successful. If a PASI of 75 is not achieved within the first, let us say, 3 months, it depends on the molecule, it depends on the pharmacokinetics of the molecule we are talking about, it depends on the half-life of the molecule, but still, let us say, considering secukinumab as the reference molecule, by week 16, you are 12, not even 16, you don't achieve PASI 75, maybe you have to think whether we are successful or not. If it is below 50 PASI, it's a primary failure. Okay, straight away it has not worked. If it is above 50 but below 75, we are confused. It may be a failure, it may be a success. This is where your DLQI is important. So you need a PASI and you need a DLQI to decide whether the patient has success or failure. If the PASI improvement is between 50 to 75 but the DLQI has reduced to below 5, it is successful. If it is DLQI is more than 5 still, that means we are not successful in treatment. If we are not successful, either we have to increase the dose or we have to reduce the interval or you have to use some other medication or change the medicine. This is a pretty old recommendation. It's still useful. But I would say that 3 to target for psoriasis has changed a lot. We are probably no longer worried about PASI 75. We are worried about PASI 90, PASI 100. We are no longer considering many of these options nowadays. Because the era of the TNF blockers seem to be almost over. We are into the 17 IL-17 blockers and the IL-23 blockers, which have changed the scenario almost totally. Now, to keep it simple, the purpose of my talk today was to say that, look, we are all professionals. As professionals and as dermatologists, we have to make a difference in the life of our patients with psoriasis. We are all aware that psoriasis is not just a skin problem. It's a psoriatic disease in which obesity, diabetes, higher chances of heart attacks and associations with malignancies are a major issue. Association with multiple organs including inflammatory bowel disease, eye problems, so many things are there in psoriasis. The quality of life of psoriasis is affected in a cumulative manner over a period of time. The lifetime burden of psoriasis is very high. We are at a stage in psoriasis understanding and treatment where it is possible to get a fantastic improvement in the shortest possible period of time, very short time, within 2 to 3 weeks you can make a huge difference and you can sustain this difference. The data for secukinumab of sustaining PASI 90 even after 5 years is quite significant. Therefore, it's possible to not only to clear psoriasis, but to maintain the clearance over a very long period of time. To keep it simple, only 4 things. We need a clear indication. There should be no contraindication. We need the checklist before biologic treatment. We need a follow-up checklist. If you have this in your file, you can make a huge difference. There's no big deal. It's a very easy process. In fact, using biologics is far easier than learning how to use methotrexate and learning how to use cyclosporine or phototherapy for that matter. And therefore, it is very, very easy. The only take-home message I would like to say is PASI and DLQI are very important. Whether you do a BSA or a PGA, it doesn't matter. But PASI and DLQI are very important. Of course, a PEST and a CASPA are important. 30% of patients with psoriasis do end up with arthritis. Complete evaluation. All of us are professionals, all of us are physicians. We don't use wrong medication for a patient when there's a contraindication. Our checklist should be clear. We don't use a medication when it is not indicated. We are not trying to sell a medicine here. We are trying to make a difference in a patient who is really sick. So when there's a clear-cut indication, when there's no contraindication, and when we are clear about how to use it, it's pretty easy. Induction, adherence and follow-up are easy. There are a few pens in front of you. If anybody has not used secukinumab, I would like you to have a look at the injection in front of you. It is very easy to take the injection. Actually, the boxes contain the demo kits. I'm sure Sarah and she can teach you how to use it. It's very easy to demonstrate to a person on how to take the injection. The injection is an auto injector pen, and it is used either on the thighs or around the navel. And it is usually given in a site where there is no active psoriasis. And this is very simple. It's almost painless. Injection right side reactions are very, very rare. And as compared to etanercept, where there are studies where you have higher chances of injection site reactions, this is very easy to use.
Thank you.